では定刻になりましたので、第13回目の計算科学特論 A の講義を始めていきたいと思います。本日は、理研アイクスから、ドクター・ジュン、来ていただいております。今日のレクチャーは、一応英語でやっていただくことになっています。ただ質疑応答は日本語でも大丈夫ですので、学生さんもあまり気にせずに、わからないことがあれば日本語で質問していただいて結構ですので、よろしくお願いします。Today his talk is Parallelization of Molecular Dynamics. Please start.
Introduction. So, now I'll talk about the parallelization scheme of molecular dynamics. In particular, particle material scheme. Last week, so there was some introduction of molecular dynamics, in particular related with fast multiple method. So I think I don't need to explain anything about the FMM scheme. So here I only focus on the particle material. So first I'll start from the overview of MD. In MD, energy and forces are described by classical molecular mechanics force field. So for each atom, we assign the atom type and we assign the potential energy according to each atom type.And from the given potential and force, we update state according to this equation of motion. So this is a Hamiltonian equation of motion. From this equation of motion, we can update coordinates and momenta according to this integration scheme. And from this integration, we can obtain the trajectory in page space. And we assume that the time average is almost identical to ensemble average, we can understand some ensemble, you can generate ensemble, and it can understand various thermodynamic quantities like free energy and some kind of radial distribution function and so on. And in this case, so generation of ensemble is very important. So for this purpose, long time and the trajectory is also very important. And the potential energy in MD is discussed in this term. The energy includes the bonding, angle, dihedral, and non-bonded interactions. Usually, bonds, angle, and dihedrals, the computational cost is order of n, where n is the number of total particles. On the other hand,the non-bonded interactions, including Van der Waals and electrostatic, the cost is usually order of n square. So this one becomes the main bottleneck in MD. So usually in particle material scheme, we distinguish this non-bonded interaction as the real space interaction and reciprocal space interaction.Real space interaction includes Van der Waals and real space electrostatic interaction. And here we introduce some cutoff values such that we do not calculate Van der Waals and electrostatic if the distance between two pair atoms is larger than such given cutoff values. And because electrostatic interaction includes very long range interaction, it's very time consuming, so we usually transform to the reciprocal space interaction using fast Fourier transformation. And because fast Fourier transformation has a computational cost as order of n log of n, the computational costs of in the reciprocal space calculation becomes order of n log of n. And So I'll explain the non-bonded interaction more precisely. So the first line is the electrostatic interaction, including all atom pairs. And because they include all atom pairs, the computation cost becomes order of n square. And in the case of Van der Waals interaction, its energy is decayed very rapidly by increasing the distance.So we can easily introduce cutoff values such that we calculate Van der Waals interaction within for atom pairs within the pair, such a cutoff value distance. On the other hand, electrostatic interaction, we couldn't introduce such cutoff values because electrostatic is one of our interactions, so long-range interaction is very important. So we convert, we express electrostatic interaction in three parts. One is real space calculation, and using complementary error function. So using this complementary error function, we can introduce cutoff values, and we can assign only atom pairs within such cutoff values. And this proposed space interaction is expressed in this way. And this cosine term is obtained from the past plate transformation. And the third is a self-energy term, which is decided only at the initial step. And because this is constant values, we don't need to calculate at every step. And from this case, we can reduce the computational cost can be reduced by properly distributing over parallel processors, in particular using good domain decomposition scheme, which will be explained later. So this is the current MD simulation status of biological systems. The first MD simulation was performed in 1977 for BPTI system with 3 picosecond simulation time with gas phase. In other words, we do not include water molecules in this simulation. From the first simulation, the time scale and space scale of the simulation becomes dramatically increased. So recently, millisecond MD simulation was available using very special MD machine named Anton. And the system size, recently, very large system named HIV virus is performed by MD using MD program. So in fact, this one includes around 70 million atoms, so very large system, and more than 100 nanosecond simulation is performed. And now, Genesis also performed almost similar size system, which includes around 100 million atom systems. So now Genesis, we performed the cloning system, including very large number of proteins. And in fact, this is very comparable to the largest system performed until now. And as you see, but even for this, the simulation time is just limited to 100 or 200 nanoseconds. The millisecond simulation is performed, can be performed for very small system. And why it is so difficult to perform long time MD simulation? It's because the one time step length is limited to 1 or 2 femtoseconds, which is due to vibrations of hydrogen atoms. So in fact, hydrogen has a very small mass and they vibrate very quickly fast. So if we increase the time step to larger than 2 or 1 femtosecond, there should be some phenomena of resonance between the hydrogen vibration and this integration. So we should definitely reduce the time step to this size. On the other hand, biological meaningful events occur on the time scale of milliseconds or longer. Even for very small system, the time scale is around a microsecond. So let's see. Vibrations is from femtosecond to picosecond level. Side chain motions from picosecond to nanosecond level, and main chain motions is between nanosecond and somehow could be larger than microsecond level. And protein folding simulation is from microsecond to millisecond, and in some cases even larger than 1 or 2 seconds. And plotting global motions is definitely larger than millisecond level. So we need to calculate energy and forces very often. It's the most challenging part in MD simulation, in particular for large scale simulation. So then how to accelerate MD simulation? So there are many ways. And last week you might hear the acceleration of MD simulation. Here another way is parallelization. For example, if instead of using one CPU, if we can use 16 CPUs, and using 16 CPUs, if we can increase the speed 16 times, somehow in this way, it can enlarge the MD simulation time. For this purpose, we need good communication and good load balance of computation. So, for good parallelization, we need small amount of computation in each CPU. And also, we need small amount of communication to increase the parallel efficiency. Nowadays, CPUs has a structure like this. In each CPUs, we have several cores. And usually, among cores, we use threaded parallelization. And between each CPU, we use MPI communication. So how can reduce the MPI communication and communication within one CPU is very critical to increase the parallel efficiency. So I think already MPI and OpenMP parallelization is explained in previous lectures. So I'll explain very briefly. So OpenMP parallelization is identical to shared memory parallelization. So all processors access the same memory. And each case, so for example, processor P1 somehow can write something on memory. Then such memory information can be used in other cores. This is shared memory parallelization. In this case, important thing is we need to decrease the memory access as small as possible. If you assume that all processors access the memory at the same time, then the shared memory parallelization will be the efficiency will not be so good. Another parallelization is MPI. In this, MPI is a message passing interface. So this one is one of the main distributed memory parallelization scheme. So each CPU access memory separately. So this process one access only memory one. And process two access only memory two. So process two does not know the information on memory one. And somehow after that, using some communication, processor two can understand the situation of processor one. And processor three can understand the situation of other processors. And it's very difficult to say which is better parallelization scheme, but usually I think MPI is better than OpenMP, even using one CPU or two CPUs. But somehow if there's some threshold in MPI parallelization, then you can use OpenMP parallelization. So that's the named hybrid parallelization using MPI and OpenMP. So in this case, each CPU has some shared memory. And in the shared memory, different processors access the same memory, and they can share the memory. And other processors also do the same thing. And between different processors, somehow using communication, we can get the data. So now I'll go to the parallelization of MD in real space calculation. So in fact, there are many parallelization schemes, and I first explain very simple parallelization. The first one is replicated data approach. So the original CHARM or AMBER program used this scheme, parallelization scheme. So before going to the current parallelization scheme, I think it's better to understand how we started the parallelization of MD. So in this case, each processor has a copy of all particle data. So assume a system and assume that there are, for example, 10 processors. Then 10 processors have the same data of coordinates and velocities. And they update at the same time. And each processor works only parts of the whole works by proper assign in do loop. For example, let's consider this is a do loop in a non-bound interaction. Assume that there are n atoms. Here, you can first assume do loop from 1 to n. And the second do loop might be from I plus 1 to n. And you can, for each ij pair, you can calculate energy and force. You can finish the energy force calculation. How can we perform parallelization in this way? So each processor, we assign rank with using MPI. And we can also understand the total number of processors. And this first, the first do loop from I equal from 1 to n is changed to in this way. So if my rank is 0, it starts from 1. And they do not calculate the case of I equals 2, but jump to I equals 1 plus total number of processors. And on the other hand, if my rank equals 1, they start from I equals 2 and jump to the next processors. In this way, we can efficiently distribute the do loop to the. And because we have some part of energy and forces, finally, we need a reduction procedure for energy and forces. And if you know MPI grammar, usually you can do this using MPI reduce or MPI all reduce or MPI all gather and so on. This one is very popular because it's very simple to implement. In fact, in Genesis, there are two MD engines. In fact, one is ATdyne and the other is SPdyne. AT means atomic decomposition. So, in fact, if you see ATdyne module, the parallelization is written in this way. Then, using this replicated data approach, how we can introduce hybrid parallelization? In fact, I don't know the best way, but in fact, the way I done is this. So in this case, works are distributed over MPI and OpenMVSLET. So for example, this one is MPI parallelization. And the same as this one. And if we introduce OpenMP, then we can define the total number of OpenMP threads, and we can define the OpenMP thread ID. So assume that there are one CPU and 8 cores, and using OpenMP, we can directly understand that total number of thread is A, and each core we can assign the thread ID from 0 to 7. And we can introduce a new identification by combining MPI rank ID and OpenMP thread ID in this way. And you can jump not every MPI process, but time multiplication of MPI processes and OpenMP thread. And after finishing this dedup calculation, we can somehow perform OpenMP deduction scheme. And finally, we can introduce MPI reduction for energy and process. Then, what's the advantage of this hybrid parallelization over MPI only? The simple thing is you can reduce the number of MPI processors involving this MPI communication. So assume that you have 10 CPU and each CPU has 8 cores. Then total number of cores is 80. You can just run this one by assigning 80 MPI processors. Then the final MPI deduction is performed among 80 processors. In this case, you can assign 10 MPI and 8 OpenMP. And the final MPI deduction becomes only performed only among 10 processors. Because we can dramatically reduce the number of communication, somehow hybrid parallelization increases the parallel efficiency. But one thing you need to keep in mind is that if we just make use of a very small number of processors, this hybrid parallelization is not necessary at all. If you use just a few number of processors, then I think just doing MD using MPI only is quite sufficient. So it's case by case. It depends on the system size, it depends on the number of processors, and it depends on the communication type. According to my experience, so if you use modern Intel CPU processors, up to 8 nodes, I think MPI is better. But if you increase the MPI processors from 16 to 32 and so on, I mean the number of CPUs, not cores, then I recommend you to use this hybrid parallelization scheme. Because in the case of OpenMP, there's some OpenMP deduction procedure, which is also very time consuming. And you need to properly assign memory access in OpenMP deduction. So I will briefly explain, say the advantage and disadvantage of this replicated data approach. Advantage is that it's easy to implement. You can easily understand. And you can easily train parallelization. But in fact, there are many disadvantages. First of all, parallel efficiency is not good at all. There is a problem of load imbalance. And usually, we prefer the situation that communication cost is reduced by increasing the number of processors. But in this way, communication cost is constant. So communication is not reduced by increasing the number of processors. And eventually, communication time is increased by increasing the number of processors. And this scheme needs allowable memory because all processors have the global data of coordinates and momentum. And memory usage is independent of the number of processors. So using this scheme, if you want to try MD simulation of containing around 1 million atom system, then you will confront a memory error problem. So this approach can be done
Unipool very, not very small, but anyway, it's a very large system. It's not applicable at all. When I tried the charm program and Genesis 89 engine, I can perform up to around 200,000 atoms. But when I increase the number of atoms from 300,000 or 400,000, then somehow I confront the problem of memory. And the second parallelization scheme is domain decomposition. This is the modern parallelization scheme. In this case, assume that this is the simulation space. And this simulation space is a first divided into subdomains according to the number of MPIs. So here, in this case, I assumed 9 MPIs. And according to 9 MPIs, I subdivided this space into 9 sections. So each section is like this. And this subdomain is further divided by the small unit of cells. And this small unit of cells is decided according to cutoff values in molecular dynamics simulation. And in this domain decomposition scheme, the domain size and cell size is quite dependent of the cutoff values. And usually, this domain subdomain size should be larger than the cutoff values. And in this domain decomposition scheme, we consider the MPI communication only among neighboring processors. So these processors communicate data to this, and this. But this one doesn't communicate to this MPI processors. So in this way, we can reduce the communication. Then, what's the advantage of this domain decomposition approach? Using this scheme, parallel efficiency becomes very good compared to the replicated data method. It's due to small communicational cost, and the amount of memory is reduced by increasing the number of processors. On the other hand, the implementation is difficult. So why it's very efficient from the memory point of view? These processors that has a data only among these processors. This processor does not need to have a data of in these particles. They only consider particles only in this subdomain and sometimes the neighboring subdomain. That's quite sufficient. So by increasing the number of processors, we can reduce the amount of data in each processors. So in the case of, for example, 1 billion atom case, it's not available for using replicated data method. But using this domain decomposition, you can simulate by increasing the number of processors very efficiently. If you consider much larger system, including 10 million or 100 billion atom case, so it's even not imaginable from replicated approach. But using this domain decomposition, somehow you can simulate. So I compared the two parallelization schemes from the point of view computation, communication, and memory. In the case of the replica data method, computation, in the ideal situation, computation can be reduced by n divided by processors. But the communication is not dependent of the number of processors, and memory is not dependent neither. But in the case of domain decomposition, computation is identical to the replica data method. The computation can be divided by number of processors. And the communication case, here I assumed a three-dimensional case. In the case of two-dimensional, the power 2 over 3 is changed to 1 half. But in the case of 3-dimensional, the number of the order of communication become like this. So if we increase the number of processors, the communication can be reduced dramatically, and it can increase the parallel efficiency. Even the memory, the necessary amount of memory is reduced by dividing the number of processors. So now I'll explain domain decomposition scheme from existing MD programs. The first one is GLOMAX. GLOMAX makes use of the so-called ACE shell scheme. In this case, we consider number of ACE shells 2 to 2, and we make an index of each cell from 0 to 7, and we somehow make a direction such that all processors send the data only to 0 processor. So it's easy to if we see the in 2-dimensional case. Here, this is the subdomain, and the communication is performed to the down and left direction, and this processor only also sends the data to left and down. In this way, this processor needs only data of this green region. They don't need data of this region, and in this way, they can reduce the communication very efficiently. And also in GLOMAX, they change the subdomain size according to number of atoms. If you see a system of, for example, protein in explicit water, usually density is very high at the center of a protein. But in some cases, if there are only water molecules, the amount of density is not so high, and number of particles is much less. So in GLOMAX, they increase the subdomain size if the density is very low, and they reduce the subdomain size if the density is very high. So in this way, they change the domain size such that all domains has the same number of particles. In this way, the load balance becomes very good. And another important thing of GLOMAX is that they distinguish the real space and reciprocal space interaction. So assume again that there are 10 processors. Then GLOMAX usually assign 7 processors for real space calculation. And at the same time, they assign 3 processors to calculate reciprocal space calculation, FFT. In fact, there is a clear reason to do this. So I'll explain later on the parallelization of a fast Fourier transformation. Anyway, in the case of FFT, parallelization is very difficult because of frequent communications among processors. And the way to increase the parallelization is to reduce the number of processors in the reciprocal space calculation. So GLOMAX assigns small number of processors in reciprocal space calculation. They assign much larger number of processors for real space calculation. So and somehow they change the number of processors such that real space and reciprocal space calculate the energy and force calculation at the same time. In fact, this is a very good parallelization scheme. And this one is named multiple problem, multiple data, PME parallelization scheme. So if I say once again, a subset of processors are assigned for this reciprocal space PME. So only very small subset of processors are assigned reciprocal space, and other processors are assigned modular space and integration. This is a parallelization scheme of GLOMEX. And another important, I'm sorry, very famous MD programs is NEMD. And in the case of NEMD, I tried to find out the most recent paper publications. But as for the domain decomposition scheme itself, I could find very old papers. So I'll explain from this one. So NEMD is based on the CHARM++ parallel program. So in NEMD, they introduced CHARM++, and CHARM++ control the computation and communication. And they assigned subdomains, generated subdomains named patchy. And these patch are decided according to MPI processors. And they generate objects according to each calculation type, and forces are calculated by independent computer objects. So for example, this is a case of one processor. Here there are two patches. And there are proxy. Proxy is the data from other processors. Somehow they is transformed to processor one. And between different patches, there is a non-bonded interaction. And also, inside each patch, there is a non-bonded interaction. And they distinguish them according by making each object. And they assign these objects by CHARM++. And they control these objects by CHARM++ to make load balance. And another domain decomposition of a program is the case of Desmond, which used the midpoint method. In fact, I think the group who introduced Desmond is very famous due to Anton. But before making Anton, they introduced Desmond MD program. And in fact, they tried many new libraries or new integration using Desmond, and eventually, if it's okay, they move it from Desmond to Anton. Anyway, Desmond has also a very good parallelization scheme. They use midpoint method. In this case, for each particle, they introduce midpoint of each atom pair. For example, here consider particle number 1 and particle number 3. The midpoint is marked X in this way. And we assign the interaction in the midpoint space. For example, here there are nine subdomains from A to I. And just assume the calculation between particle number 3 and particle number 4. In GLOMEX or NEMD, either particle number 4 is data is transformed, communicated to part not here, or the data of particle number 3 is exported to this subdomain. Well, in the midpoint method, the calculation is performed at the midpoint, so in F subdomain. So particle data number, particle 3 data is moved to so F subdomain, and particle data number 4 particle data is also transformed to subdomain F, and here they calculate. So this scheme can be applied not only for non-bounded but also bounded interaction. Then what is the advantage of this midpoint method? So if I go back to this scheme, usually you need to communicate data up to cutoff distance. But in this midpoint scheme, we can communicate only up to half of cutoff distance. Because particle data 3 is not send, need to send here. They can just send data to the midpoint position. So, in this sense, every particle, the information is sent only up half of cutoff distance. This is the advantage of midpoint method. And in fact, Genesis program, I used very similar scheme of midpoint method named midpoint cell method. So this is a midpoint method. Here I use the subdomain 4. And in the case of midpoint method, I need to check midpoint for each atom pair, which is very time consuming in fact. For each every atom pair, I should consider, I should check where is the midpoint. And I thought that this is a very time consuming work. I decided not to check this midpoint, but introduce cell concept. So each subdomain is subdivided by cells. And I assign the intersection space by deciding the midpoint cells from given cell pair. Just let's consider interaction between particle A and particle B. In the midpoint method, they check the midpoint of particle A and B. Oh, the midpoint is in subdomain 2. Let's assign subdomain 2 for the calculation between particle A and B. And particle C and D, midpoint is subdomain 4. So let's assign the interaction space on subdomain 4. But in this case, particle A and C is cell index 10. Particle B and D is cell index 8. Then I define the midpoint cell of these and these cell pairs. There might be possible candidates because midpoint cell is not uniquely defined. Then I decide the midpoint cell as a cell containing less number of atoms. Because if this cell contains small number of atoms, they can quickly finish the calculation. So I can assign more load to this one. In some cases, they can be uniquely defined. For example, atoms in cell 1 and cell 3, the midpoint cell is cell 2, so the interaction between these two atoms are performed here. In this way, I can define the interaction space. In this way, like the midpoint method, midpoint cell, they only need to communicate data up to half of cutoff distance. So this subdomain, they don't need to import data not beyond the half of cutoff. And because this is symmetric, somehow it can first send data in upper and send the data in the left and right in this way. And the number of communications is also can be performed within three communication steps. So based on this scheme, I introduced midpoint cell scheme such that every subdomain sends and receives data only up to half of distance. I decide the cell as the size of half of the cutoff distance. And then what's the merit and demerit of a midpoint cell method or midpoint method compared to ACCL scheme? In fact, if you consider only the amount of communication, they are equal to each other. Communication of your space are identical. But good thing of this scheme is they are symmetric. So if we use a special network like 3D Torus in K computer, This can be more advantageous. And I'll explain later, but this one is also very useful if we consider particle measurement scheme. Because in this way, we can reduce one communication from real to reciprocal space when sending from real to this reciprocal space data. I'll explain this in the later slide. Based on this scheme, you can consider hybrid parallelization. For example, this is a hybrid parallelization scheme in Genesis. So the basic is the domain decomposition with a midpoint size scheme. And each node consists of at least two cells in each direction. And within nodes, we assign cell calculation, for example, using OpenMP. And for different nodes, we assign only endpoint to point communication like MPI send and MPI receive among processors. So in this way, the amount of communication can be reduced. Here I explained only the MPI parallelization scheme. Then how we can properly implement OpenMP parallelization scheme. This is one example in Genesis. How Genesis deal with shared memory parallelization. Here I use cell-wise particle data. Usually, consider this simulation space and assume that each one is a subdomain. Usually, in the memory space, the data is written in this way. So, but the data is not sequentially accessed. So, for example, even the same cell, if you assign the first particle and second particles, somehow you need to jump in the memory space. But in shared memory parallelization, memory access is very important. Such jump in memory space, in memory in hardware, it's shared good parallelization cannot be obtained. So I assigned the cell-wise particle data such that in each cell, the particles are also written in the same address or neighboring address in memory. In this way, you can access the data sequentially, not randomly. Then, how to parallelize by OpenMP? Based on this cell-wise particle data, you can assign the non-bonded interaction as the interaction of cell pairs. And in fact, the cell pairs has somehow large amount. So such cell pairs are distributed over OpenMP set. In this way, in each thread, we access the memory very locally. And random memory access is not performed in this way. So I found that it dramatically increased the OpenMP parallelization. But now, until now, I explained the parallelization of MD for the real space. But in fact, I found that the recent trend of MD is moving from CPU to GPU, in fact. And now CPU has much amount of cache. On the other hand, GPU has quite a small but large amount of arithmetic and logic unit. So recent MD program like GLOMEX, Ember, or NAMD makes use of GPU and has a much larger performance. So I think parallelization on GPU also important. So now I move to the parallelization of MD in reciprocal space interaction. So I come back to electrostatic interaction in particle mesh world. I said that electrostatic interaction is divided by real space, reciprocal space, and self-energy. And this reciprocal space interaction is obtained by using B-spline and C-spline approximation and Fourier transformation of charges. So because of this Fourier transformation, polarization of in reciprocal space interaction becomes very difficult. So the polarization of PME becomes identical to polarization of fast Fourier transformation. So I'll explain this. Before going to the polarization, I'll just simply explain the MPI all-to-all, MPI and MPI all-gate communication. So in fact, you don't need to care so much about the MPI altogether, but I think it's better to keep in mind MPI all-to-all communication. Here, it's like this. Processor 0 has a data of A0, B0, C0, D0, and E0. And processor 1 has a data of A1, B1, C1, D1, E1, and so on. So each processor has a raw data. Using MPI all-to-all communication, processor 0 has a data of A0, A1, A2, A3, A4. And processor 2 has a data of B0, B1, B2, B3, B4 in this way. So MPI all-to-all is identical to matrix transports. You can easily consider matrix transports in using MPI all-to-all communication. And first, I'll explain the polarization of a fast Fourier transformation using SLAP, in other words, 1D decomposition scheme. This one is very widely used in almost FFT libraries like FFTW, FFTE, and so on. And the older version of GLOMAX also used this decomposition scheme. In this case, each processor is assigned as a slab of size n times n times n over p for computing FFT on p processors. This one is the parallel scheme of FFTW library. And in fact, this one is very easy to implement. And we can reduce the frequency of communication. Here, only two MPI all-to-all communication is quite sufficient. But in this case, the grid size N should be divisible by process P. So if you consider this, it's like this. Here, there are four processors. And each processor has a data like this. And they perform FFT in Z direction and Y direction. They can do separately, independently. But after that, they need to do FFT in X direction. But for FFT in X direction, here they need the data. And they do all-to-all communication and have some global data in that direction. This is the most commonly used FFT polarization scheme. And this one is named SLAP decomposition. And you can do 2D FFT along the two local dimensions. And we need only one global transpose and 1D FFT along third dimension. So one communication, and in MD, because there are forward FFT and backward FFT, two transports is necessary in this case. So it's very fast if we use very small number of processors. But if you assign very large number of processors, then this one is not recommended because maximum parallelization is limited to the length of the largest edges of the grid data. The next is the 2D decomposition. In other words, it's named pencil decomposition because it's like a pencil. So in this case, we need two all-to-all communication. Assume that there are P times Q processors, and there are N times N times N FF degrees. Then each processor has a data of N times N over P times N over Q. And in fact, this one is also quite widely used. In the newest version of GloMax, use this decomposition. NAMD program also makes use of this decomposition. In Japan, the widely and very famous FFT library like FFTE also makes use of this decomposition. Somehow, this is an auto communication scheme. So, in fact, in PME, this composition has like this steps. FFT along the first dimension, transpose, second dimension, transpose, third dimension, and global transpose. In this way, we can perform FFT calculation. This is some pseudocode, in fact, written in Genesis in 8-dime module, but I'll just skip this one. And in Genesis, and I considered the way to increase the FFT parallelization. And I thought that it might be preferred to reduce the number of processors in each of communication instead of increase the frequency of the communication. From the two-dimensional view, I'll explain the FFT. This is a conventional method. So assume that we have each subdomain have a data in this way. And first, we need the FFT in this direction. Then, we need communication among these processors, 1, 2, 3, 4, and among 5, 6, 7, 8, and so on. And each one has a data like this. When you can perform FFT in X direction. And the problem is the next step. If you want to perform FFT in Y direction, you need all-to-all communication among these 16 processors, and you can make it this way. This is a conventional view. But in Genesis, I'm sorry, I skipped one slide. But in Genesis, I wanted to make another procedure, not to do this MPIO directly. Here, I'll explain in 3D dimension case. Here, this cubic is the simulation space, and each small cubic is a subdomain space. So first of all, each subdomain has a data in each domain. First of all, I wanna perform FFT in this direction. For this purpose, somehow each processor has a global data in this direction. But this one has only very part of the data in this direction. From using this data, FFT is not available. So, I made the MPI all-to-all to make this kind of data for each processor. Each processor has a data of some kind of plate in this way, using from this to this. So for this, to get this data, I only need a communication only among these four processors. And another four processors also need all-to-all communication. But this communication is independent of communication among these processors. I can perform independent MPI all-to-all communication only among small subsets of processors. And I can make this kind of data. And I can perform FFT in this direction. And the next is this direction. How to do? So I just make the data to come back to the original type using all-to-all. And then next, we can perform MPI all-to-all communication among processors on the same on the y-axis. So for this case, we can make MPI all-to-all communication among these four processors, among these four processors, and so on. And you can make this kind of data and perform FFT in this direction. And finally, make the original term, and for the last direction, FFT in last direction, you can make MPI all-to-all among these processors. So in this way, somehow we can introduce good parallelization of FFT. So in fact, this one requires much more frequency of communication. But good thing is that we can reduce the number of processors involving in each communication. Of course, it's a problem of latency and bandwidth. But according to my impression, increasing the number of processors and to reduce the communication frequency sometimes pays to obtain good parallelization. In particular, it depends on the network structure. If you consider topology network, then I noticed that this kind of parallelization could be more useful. And using this way, in fact, now I'll explain why this parallelization scheme is very useful. Usually, in many programs like GLOMEX or NAMD, in particular, if you consider NAMD, first of all, they have the data in cubic, here in square. And in each square, they divide the data. And they decide the processor length according to each data. For example, they send this processor, send this data to this processor, and this one is also send the same length in this way. And they perform the FFT not using cubic, but in slab or pencil decomposition scheme. And here, anyways, communication is necessary. If you consider SSL scheme, it's slab or pencil decomposition. But if you consider midpoint cell method with cubic decomposition, then when you send the data from this real space to this space, communication is not necessary at all, because this processor has the data of its subdomain and margin space, and this subdomain and margin space is quite sufficient to make data of this reciprocal space. So in this way, we can skip one communication when you send the data of charge from real to reciprocal space. But on the other hand, if you see the NAMD program, they make a communication, they introduce a communication scheme when you send the data from here to this protocol. And in fact, this is the more important bottleneck of parallelization in MD. So based on this, now I'll just briefly show the benchmark result. The first one is Glomex in 2013. They checked the parallel performance for these five systems. And if you consider the very large system, including 7.5 million atoms, scalability is like this. Scalability is very good, even though they're using a small number of processors. And as you know, so Glomex is a very good tuned program. And even using small number of processors, they show good performance. And this one is the most recent NAMD parallel performance result on CPUs using this one is on Titan. Now, if you are interested in the world top 500 supercomputers, now Titan is the world second. This one is performed on the machine. And for 1 million atom system and 100 million atom system, yeah, parallel efficiency is very good. And this one is NAMD performance on BlueJean Q. In fact, BlueJean Q is very similar to K computer. BlueJean Q contains only CPUs, there's no GPU, and they use a Torus network. And even the BlueJean Q, the performance is very good. And I also checked performance of Genesis on K computer. And this one is the 1 million atom system on K computer. So pink is NAMD and red is Genesis SP9 engine. For small number cores, in fact, unfortunately, NAMD was slightly faster than Genesis. But if you consider parallelization, Genesis shows much better scalability on K computer. How about the other? I also checked the parallel performance for large system. The first one is containing around 12 million atom systems, which includes large number of proteins, ATP, and so on. And this is the parallel performance result. So it's scalable up to 130,000 nodes, and I can perform the benchmark performance is around slightly larger than 16 nanoseconds per day. In fact, noticeable fact is that here I didn't use any multiple time step integrator. So every step I introduce not only real but also reciprocal space calculation, even though. So using such a parallel scheme, so I could find good parallel efficiency. This one is some simple movie for such a system. So each one is 14. And this one is a result of in the simulation of 15 nanosecond. But that's so impressive, not so interesting. But this one is just for showing that Genesis can handle very well for this system. And another, this one is a very challenging work because this one containing around 100 billion atom system. So if you consider mycoplasma, and pull out 1/8 of this part, and they conclude, they consist of proteins like that. And on K computer, the parallel performance was not bad. So it was scalable up to 262,000 cores, And the benchmark, it can be obtained around slightly less than 6 nanoseconds per day. But if I use multiple time step integrators, so it could be larger than 8 nanoseconds per day. So somehow, this is just example of benchmark calculation. And I do not think that now parallelization scheme on Genesis is not is the best scheme. It may not be the best scheme, but somehow I think such parallelization I said for in this talk might be somehow useful for you to understand the one example of a parallelization on of MD program. So this is just a summary. Parallelization of MD is important because we need to obtain the long time MD trajectory, which is very important to make the many thermodynamic conductors. And domain decomposition scheme is used for minimal communication and computational cost. And hybrid parallelization is very helpful to increase the parallel efficiency. And parallelization of FFT is very important when you use particle mesh UART scheme in MD. In fact, there are several decomposition schemes of parallel FFT. And here I just suggested the cubic decomposition scheme with the midpoint cell could be a very good solution for efficient parallelization. That's all. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. For very intense talk.